Okay, we are live. We are live on
Hey,
Facebook.
hi.
We are recording. We have broadcasted. We have people joining us. I think we have pressed all the correct buttons. Woohoo! All right, welcome, welcome, welcome. I see lots and lots of people joining us. We're very, very excited to be with you here today. We are talking about one of the hottest topics in real estate today. Listings. And I'm super excited to be joined by my guests. They are some of my favorite people, some of the smartest people I know, and also some of the most fun. So we're going to have a really good conversation for you today. It's going to be a ton of fun. So a little bit of housekeeping before I introduce my guests, and we're going to dive in. We are expecting a bunch of Q&A today. So as always, if you have questions for our guests, please drop them in Q&A, and feel free to use the chat liberally. Jump in there, tell us how amazing we look, how much fun we are, all of that good stuff. But absolutely, if you have questions, drop those in Q&A. That'll be really helpful for us. So welcome, friends. This is going to be a lot of fun. We're going to talk listings today. I'd like to introduce my guests. First of all, we have Sherry Brown and Zach McReynolds from Next Home Real Estate Rock Stars. They are some of the top agents in Santa Clarita, California. Say that five times fast. And they are known for their innovative approach to online marketing and old school connections. I love a little bit of old school, new school cocktail. So welcome, guys.
Thanks for having
Hello.
us. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Francie.
Lots of fun. And also Jimmy Mackin, one of my favorite people in the industry, CEO of Curator, a full service digital marketing company focused on helping agents get more listings. How fitting is that? And co-author of his new book, Exactly What to Say for Real Estate Agents, and host of the podcast Water Cooler. Welcome, Jimmy.
Valerie, thank you for having me. And I'm excited about today's session. We had over 1,200 people registered for today's topic. And I think it's an indication of how important this conversation is going to be over the next hour. Because I think every single agent wakes up in the morning wondering when are they going to get their next listing. And I think right now, the focus for everyone who's listening today is going to be around developing strategies needed to actually grow their business. So I'm excited about today. I know we have a lot to dive into. So let's get after it.
Awesome. So my first question for you is, how are the very best in the business getting listings right now? I'd love to hear from each of you, like, where are they coming from? How are the best getting them? And, what are they doing to get them? Like, how are they standing out?
I think for me personally, I think, I've reflected just on this year alone. We've been on a dozen, couple dozen listing appointments. And for us, it's having the gift of gab. It's having conversations and talking and sharing our knowledge and not just expecting the listing, but working for it.
I love that. Conversation's so critical, right? And so many people just think, oh, I can just skip that whole talking to humans part.
Right. We still have to pick up the phone. I mean, technology's great. Instagram, Facebook, we love it. We use it. We utilize it a lot. But picking up the phone is still one of the best methods.
We just completed something called the Seller Sprint last week with our clients, and we basically did a 7-day challenge where we did a bunch of tactics to help them generate more listings leading up to the spring. And what we found was really interesting. We gathered data from over 500 clients, and we were able to determine that it takes on average 7.32 conversations to book a single listing appointment. So to Sherry's earlier point, conversations are key. They're critical. So the question that should be going through every single person's mind right now, and the thought that needs to be at the forefront of your strategy is, how do I have more conversations? Now, my opinion of that is it starts with education. Sellers are desperate to be informed about what's going on in the market. We tend to believe that the way to communicate to sellers today is all about home values are on the rise, sell your homes today. And that is inside baseball speak that consumers have been conditioned to ignore. What we need to be doing is saying, okay, if home values are on the rise, if homes are selling on average 25% faster, if inventory levels are down 34% across the country, why aren't more people selling? And that answer to that question is the beginning of your content strategy. So I would just echo what Sherry's saying is conversation is key and conversation is essential. You have to have, you know, 5 to 7 conversations at a time to be able to get a single listing appointment, but never mind a signed listing. But we have to say, what information can we produce to be able to start more conversations? That's the question we have to answer, guys.
Yep, I agree. And that great point about how many conversations you have to have. My personal goal on a daily basis is to have at least 10 new conversations with my Sphere database about real estate each day. And when I'm having a slower day, I try to reach about 30 conversations a day, Monday through Friday. And that's what my goal is every day. Even when our busiest, you know, sometimes we're in back-to-back appointments. If I know I have a busy day, then I wake up in the morning and spend an extra hour in the morning or at night when I get home at 7-8 o'clock PM and I'll strike up, you know, 10 conversations real quickly because that's what's going to keep that consistent flow.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious to get some feedback in the chat there, Valerie. How many of you right now have a daily conversation goal? Just drop yes or no in the chat for us.
Yeah, I love that. So many people say yes, but then I know a ton of people. Yeah, we've got a lot of no's in there too. Lots of no's. Whoa, a lot of no's. I mean, so critical, right? Even if that number is a simple, like 5 conversations a day, which is totally doable, like really understanding how people can like systemize this is critical, right?
Yeah.
Just like have a process for a number. And if you don't have a number, like what are you even aiming at?
Right. Well, and I think the biggest thing is people don't know where or who to have the conversations with. We get in our own head and afraid to have the conversation with our best friend or with the lender or with escrow. They're afraid to ask for the business or talk about the business because they think maybe they talk about real estate too much, or they're afraid to go into their database and strike up conversation with a random stranger you met 2 years ago. It's okay to be uncomfortable. Being uncomfortable is what's going to make you feel better.
There's a comment in chat right now that I want to address. Angela said, how many times can I call my same 60 people about real estate? Like, let's talk about that for a minute. Like, I know we do have people on this call that are newer to the business or have smaller databases, and they're sitting here thinking conversations are great. You guys are right. You know, like have conversations every day, but with who and how do I talk to the same people about the same things? Let's address that.
I think the biggest thing is, yes, you can talk to your 60 people over and over about real estate. Like you said, Jimmy, it's all about content. Do you have content? If you spend an hour a day educating yourself on the market or about real estate or about your community, you can easily talk to your database, those same 60 people over and over and over, because every day you have something new to say and people love talking about real estate. What I hate is going to a party knowing I have to talk about real estate because I can never be off. I have to be on. Mm. So people love it. We get in our own head that they don't love it. It's us who have that fear and everything. Not having the conversations, we stop ourselves with fear. And once you put fear aside, then you go full steam ahead and you can have those conversations easily over and over and over. I love talking.
Well, being knowledgeable is the key there. You know, you can't just keep hitting people up and go, hey, I appreciate your referrals. You got to have some value. You got to have the content. You got to provide something of value to them. Or what is their trust in you? What are you providing?
Yeah.
We just had a listing appointment last week and it was a lady we met at a charity event 2 years ago. And, you know, I talked to her every month about real estate. I always think I'm annoying her because I don't really know her. We met very briefly. And when we went to go take photos of her listing, she has a picture of us in her house.
Aww.
True story.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So first off, I think we have to address the first issue with Angela, which is she's got a network of 60 people. Right, that she's talking about. Priority number 1, 2, and 3 is to raise awareness that you exist to people who are not currently in your database. Redfin put out some data recently indicating that about 15%, we have 15% fewer listings now than we did the year prior in 2020. And that was actually already down probably 20-25% from the year prior in 2019. So what that means for me is the pie is getting smaller. And if you want to grow your business, you need a bigger piece of that pie. So what we should assume safely is that if we were banking on 15 or 20 or 30 deals this year to come from our network or sphere of influence, we should estimate about 20% of that is going to be sitting on the sidelines for a whole various reason. They can't find a new home. They're going to wait to see how the pandemic plays out. They want to see what happens with the economy. So you should assume that you're going to have to grow your network by at least 20% to make up the basically the loss that you're experiencing from this year. What I believe to be the strategy here is, like, I'll give you a script. Let's get really practical here for a second. I just shared this yesterday on my Instagram, and one of my clients emailed me, and she got seven seller or listing appointments from this one script. And it's a way to start a conversation without basically, let's say, repeating yourself over and over again. It goes like this. The subject line of this can be "name your price." Now, I would recommend sending this as a one-to-one message, but the subject line should read "name your price." The copy reads, "Hi, Valerie, a quick update on the market. Last week, 123 Main Street sold for 13% above asking price. In total, it had 25 offers. Just out of curiosity, do you have a, quote, I'd be crazy not to sell, end quote, price in mind? Can't wait to hear your answer." And all I'm trying to do is start a conversation about real estate, but I'm tying it to a timely, relevant, market update, as opposed to saying, here's the market update, here's the absorption rate, which, by the way, no one knows what absorption rate means, right? Like, consumers, here's a list of every single house that's sold. Like, it needs to be short, sweet, to the point, a direct call to action. And that gets people saying, actually, I do have a price in mind. And they say it's, 20% above what I paid for, or what I thought it was last year. And now you could say, okay, cool. Actually, we have a buyer who'd be willing to pay that crazy price because the market's so insane. Mm-hmm. So, like, this is an example of one small script, but like coming up with creative ways to start conversations, it has to be a focal point, and you have to be creative, clearly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think some of the questions that are coming in really do, like, the answer to that really is you have to be creative. You know, if you're going to the same well for listings that everyone else is, if you're looking for expireds right now, if you're looking for, people who bought their house 7 years ago or more, and might be moving. If you're just planning on using those old school methods, you're not being creative enough, because in this market, you have to find ways to have different conversations with those people, because you are going to have to talk to your database over and over again about the same thing in different ways.
Yeah.
So creativity is super important.
If I could just add one thing real quickly, because Danielle in the chat said the biggest reason people won't list is they have no place to go. How do you solve that problem? Excellent question. That is the central problem. Well, I haven't seen anybody, and I've been complaining about this for 2 months now, put out an article about 10 things you can do or 10 places you can live if you sell your home and you're not ready and you don't have a new one to move into. No one's putting out content marketing that addresses the problem. My mother calls me up 3 months ago. She goes, "Jimmy, I want to list my property. I'm inviting a realtor over." I said, "Great. I want to be a part of it," but we couldn't because of COVID. So I said, "Okay, go." The realtor comes over. She goes, this is what she says to my mom. "This is a smart agent. This is a really smart agent." Yeah. She goes, "I think we can get $650 for your property, way above what my mom imagined to be able to sell it for." And she goes, "But I want you to know something. Like, you have to make sure you have a place to move into afterwards because the home's going to sell really quickly." Mm-hmm. She thought she was being helpful by saying, "You got to move out," but she provided no next steps. My mom's like, "Shit, where am I going to move?" Right?
And so, the crap out of her.
What, 3 months later, she wants a sale. She hasn't listed. She's on the sidelines because there hasn't been any information about short-term rentals, corporate rentals, vacation rentals. You can live anywhere in the world in this remote world that we live in. Mm-hmm. This goes back to Sherry's earlier point and Zach's earlier point about education. This is the area we have to educate on, Valerie. This is the focus.
And I think that leads to my next question. I was going to ask is, how can somebody best stand out in a market like this? And you just offered a really good answer on that, is give what your competition is not, go that extra step and tell the people what they don't know, but then tell them what your competition is not telling them. I mean, Zach, Sherry, are you having these conversations with people right now around where they're going to live?
Yeah. I mean, and I think a listing, we took four listings last week. Obviously they all had, over 70 showings, all had multiple offers. I think 10 was the minimum. Sherry was working one where, they're moving out of state. It's they wanted a rent back, but if you got an additional 50,000, you can get a pretty sick Airbnb somewhere. for 50,000.
And that was the conversation I had with them. I said, I knew it was going to be a hot property. And I said, name the price that makes it make sense for you to go to an Airbnb with your two dogs and two kids. Is there a price in mind? And she goes, well, if we got 20,000 over asking, I'd sell today. Okay, great. How about 80,000 over asking and 60 days free rent back? Are you willing to move now? Yes. Okay, great. Easy. And I think a big part of what Zach and I have noticed that has set us apart in our listing presentation is we walk in with a plan in place that they almost can't say no because they forgot they didn't have a plan. They forgot that they're just going with what we're saying because it's all laid out. When we say, hey, we have house cleaners coming on Monday. We're going to take pictures Monday afternoon. We're going on the market on Wednesdays. Showings are Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. You need to get an Airbnb for the weekend. Do not be home because we plan on selling the house on Monday. We're going to get you a rent back. We're going to give you a great price. And then we're going to figure out where you're going to go. And it'll be easy.
Right. And I wouldn't, you know, really good agents right now are doing their homework around like how to stage and how to get all their vendors in order. But they're also the ones saying, here are three really great Airbnbs in the area where your kids go to school that will take your pets, and they will, you know, and they're looking for somebody who, you know, would take 2 or 3 months and live in it, and it's a win-win, and here you go. Right. So you don't have to worry about where you're going to live. We've helped you figure that out until you can buy. Those are, you know, those are conversations that are no brainers these days.
And if just to interject a thing that I'm not a big fan of right now, so something to not do, maybe every agent in town could stop posting, it's a hot market. And then because everyone's complaining that you're getting beat up on your commission. But if that's your value is just saying it's simply a hot market and you don't have a marketing plan or a system in place to show your value, then how are you going to, I mean, we are going up against 4 or 5 agents on every single listing we go on. And there's definitely people out there cutting their commissions like crazy right now. Mm-hmm. So you got to have that value to be able to fight for that commission.
Right. Yeah. The biggest thing we've been saying is, I understand that this agent's willing to do it for XYZ price, but with our strategic marketing and our strategic pricing plan, we're able to get you the unknown. Would you like to get 10,000 or 15,000 over asking, or would you like to get the unknown, such as a free rent back, 100,000 over asking, great terms? I'm here to negotiate price, but is the agent going to negotiate terms for you? I'm focused on appraisal contingency, inspection contingency. So the agent who's going to discount that, they're not going to negotiate those terms for you. And that's where you're going to lose.
And in our listing presentation, we have examples of our last 10 properties and what we sold for and what the competition, the neighborhood sold for. And every single time we're selling for more money. So we're laying it out. We have this marketing plan. Here's all the views we're getting through targeted marketing on Facebook, on YouTube, on Instagram. Getting all those views is driving more people to the property, which is driving the price up. So you can list with us and get price X, or look at our competition in that neighborhood. And we got, you know, on some of these, we've got 200,000 over, or 40,000 over, or 50,000 over. We can quantify that in our listing presentation. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you know, it's funny when we talk about commission, because I think a lot of agents are getting beat up on commission really bad right now because it's such a hot market, because homes are selling so quickly. They say, what's the value proposition? So I think one of the least understood and most talked about topics in real estate is brand. Let me define brand for the audience here to give some perspective. Brand is all of the intangible and tangible touch points that a customer experiences in their journey that create a association, a feeling. So we think about that in only one stage, which is marketing and advertising. But there's a professor NYU Stern who introduced what we refer to as the clock model, which is the three phases. You have pre-purchase, which is marketing and sales. You have purchase, which is the experience, right? The listing presentation, signing the contract. And then there is post-purchase, which is actually you listing and selling their home for them. Every single touch point along that journey creates an association feeling. And if it's a negative, meaning you show up late to the listing appointment, or you come unprepared, or your marketing is terrible and your website's ugly and you have no advertising, or let's say the showing process is really like, you don't tell them they got to be in an Airbnb and they're scrambling last minute to move. If that every single experience that they have throughout those touch points, if those are negatives, then it has a negative impact on the reflection of your brand. So what great agents do is they understand fundamentally that if I'm going to be a premium service, if I'm going to charge a premium price, I got to act like it. And they deliver on that in every step of the process, not just with their marketing, which is a big part of it, but with the actual listing presentation and the listing appointment and the consultation. Mark Davidson actually had a great point recently. He was saying that we need to change the language of a listing appointment because that's something that we think about internally. And, you know, we started to brainstorm ideas on Twitter. And I think one of the ideas we came up with is like, you're going to schedule a listing appointment. You say, hey, listen, we have a go-to-market strategy, which we're going to have a discussion around bringing your property to market and a plan around how to maximize the results to get you the best results you want for your home. So from a brand perspective, we have got to be honest with ourselves. If we are charging, you know, if we are charging Nordstrom prices and giving people, you know, H&M product, we are going to get our lunches eaten by the competition, period. And so this is, Valerie, I want to be real with everyone here because I don't want to waste your guys' time. Like, you got to look yourself in the mirror and ask, am I actually doing something that's exceptional? Because if I'm charging premium prices and I'm delivering, you know, an average product, you know, you are not going to win in this market, period. And clearly, Sherry and Zach are doing things that other agents are either unwilling to do or haven't even thought about doing, which is why they've been able to get so much success lately.
Yeah.
I think those are great points. Absolutely. That is a big point, because if you don't provide that service, of course, they're going to hyper-focus on commission. The seller, when you walk in, all they're thinking about is how much do you cost? And what we love is when they ask us what our commission is and we say, we charge the same as everybody else, but you get us. So we're not having to discount our commissions because they're not even thinking about it. And they go, okay, great. We went two listing appointments yesterday. Neither seller asked us how much we charge.
Yeah.
Didn't even ask. And it wasn't even a question. And here's the listing contract. This is what it is. This is what you're going to pay. One of the appointments, it's the guy's an agent. He didn't even ask for a referral fee. And I'm like, you're a licensed agent hanging it at a different brokerage. I'll give you a referral fee. Like, it's okay. And he's like, I just really want you on my side. And if I'm going to hire you, I need you and I need the best. I'm like, okay, great. Mm-hmm. Let me help.
Yeah. You don't walk into a Ferrari dealership and ask them, what's the price? Right.
Yeah.
And you don't haggle. There's a wait list and it creates scarcity. And I think we have to have, listen, each of you can only scale to your own abilities. Unless you build a mega team and you step out of production, like, you can only sell a certain amount of houses per year. You need to think about yourself as a scarcity, because your time is a scarcity. And therefore you should be really selective about who you bring on and how you bring them on. So yeah, I just have this strong belief, Valerie, that at the end of the day, you know, we the biggest lie our industry has told us is that Zillow is going to take away our business because they're a technology company. They're not. They're not a technology company. They're a customer experience company.
Yeah.
And if we compete on customer experience at the local level, we win.
Yeah.
If we try to compete with them on the technology level, good luck.
Yeah.
Right? Like, that's not what the consumers are looking for.
Yeah. So true. And I want to come back to your marketing, branding conversation there for a minute, which I think is super important. We kind of touched on this in the beginning as well, when you said, hey, you know, like, right now, everybody's just kind of throwing out marketing that says the market is so hot, you know, like, everything's selling over asking. It's super hot market. And I have feels about all of that, as you probably know. But like, what should our mindset be towards marketing when the market is so hot? Like, why is it equally as important to talk to the market and not just about how hot the market is, but why is it equally important, or even maybe more so important, to market right now properly when the market is hot? Because I know a lot of agents that are like, I don't have to do professional photography right now. I don't have to throw a bunch of money into marketing. The property's going to sell itself. It's going to sell really quickly. I'm just going to slap this big giant just sold over asking on that property afterwards and call it a day.
Yeah, they're stupid. They're stupid and short-sighted. That's the answer, right? Sorry if that offends people, but like, it's such a short-term mindset that is fixated on, like, if you plan on being business for only the next 6 months, go ahead. Who cares? If you're trying to build something of substance, right? You have to make investments. And by the way, forget about the fact that a consumer is hiring you and paying you a premium to deliver an A+ experience. Forget about that for a second, okay? Mm-hmm. Like, your obligation, your fiduciary responsibility. It's just bad business.
Yeah.
Your listing is your best asset, and right. When you
market your business,
Exactly. And like, if you market your listing super aggressively, even though you know it's not gonna have that big of an impact on the list, on the sale price of the property, what you're doing is you're demonstrating to the world that I'm really good at my job, and you're gonna get sellers who see what you're doing and say, I want that for my house.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm. Agreed. Yep. 100%. And regardless on price point, we've always believed that regardless if it's a $100,000 condo or a $2 million mansion, regardless, mm-hmm. that client that is the $200,000 condo deserves the same respect. They don't mm-hmm. deserve anything less because they're too, now maybe the budgeting is a little bit less. So we cut down on our advertisements through the different websites because we've got to be careful what we spend, but they still deserve professional photography. They deserve the video walkthrough, the floor plans. They deserve all of that stuff. And, mm-hmm. you know, I got into real estate in 2003. I was a new agent at one point. I'm embarrassed about some of my listings that still are on the internet where I'm like, ooh, look at those photos. What was I thinking? Oh my gosh, look at my headshot. Did I take that in prison? Like, that is out there forever. And that is a part of me. And I have to live with that. So I wish I would have started younger and gone back and done the professional photos the way I should have at that time. Mm-hmm. And not just said, I don't have the money to do that. Mm-hmm. It's being mindful of what to spend money on.
Well, that's the thing. People are watching. People are always watching. You're not necessarily marketing even just to get eyeballs on the house right now in this market. You're marketing for the other eyeballs that are watching how you market.
We always say, if you were on a dating site, you wouldn't post a selfie with a double chin and no makeup. Your listing deserves that same respect. It's on a dating site.
Yeah.
Presentation matters. How your house looks online is important to me. Like if I was going on Tinder.
Yeah. And that's the first impression of your house at this point. Let's be honest, is how it looks in those pictures. The moment somebody's pocket dings, ding, ding, ding. Uh-oh, a house just hit with my criteria and they open it. That is your moment. Mm-hmm. Crappy pictures, or God forbid, not actually putting the pictures in. You've seen the agents that write in the MLS that pictures will be up tomorrow. Like, you know, you missed your moment. That was your moment.
Yeah. To go back to your original question, I love what Sherry and Zach are saying. Like it's what they refer to in branding as a quality cue. It's mm-hmm. a signal that to the world, like what your acceptable standard is. So if you're putting out crappy photos, it means you're a crappy agent. That's the connection they make, right? Low quality product equals low price. That's the connection we make as consumers every single day. But to answer your question directly, what's another marketing idea that can be an ongoing marketing idea that agents can lean into to sort of build their network, educate the consumer, and start winning more listings? A client of mine named Heather Buckman has a strategy that I just absolutely love. I think she's just truly brilliant to execute this. She uses a storytelling tactic where every week she shares a personalized story about a home buying or home buyer, or home seller. And she talks about the messy, nasty, dirty part of real estate, which no one wants to talk about, right? It's the exact opposite, right? She's depositioning the competition by showing the inner workings of deals falling apart, financing not coming together, like everything you guys deal with every single day. She shares that, and it always has like a happy ending because, you know, comes full circle, obviously. She shares it, like she doesn't share things in the middle of the process. She shares the end of the process. But at the end of the email, so she shares these stories, and these stories are super relatable. So that's the first thing she does. But the second thing she does in her weekly newsletter, she says, here's a detailed list of active, serious buyers and what they're looking for. Yeah. Reply to this email if you own a property in these areas and you're interested in selling. So it's the classic, we have buyers, but it's delivered in a modern storytelling format. Every week she gets replies from people saying, hey, A, I love your emails. Thanks so much. I really love the story this week. And B, I actually do know somebody who has a house that you might want to talk to. And so this sort of storytelling with the we have buyers angle is a incredibly smart way to have an ongoing conversation with your database about real estate without saying every single day, sold over asking price, sold over asking price, market super hot, right? I'll have a visual of it. I'll share it afterwards and get to you, Valerie, so you can share it with the audience today. But this is the marketing that I want to see more agents doing right now if they want to win more listings.
I saw a really good one this week on Facebook, and I can't remember who posted it, so I'm apologizing in advance, but they literally took a map of, you know, Denver, and they circled like on street lines, three very small but specific neighborhoods. And then next to each one of those circles said, I have a buyer that wants this area, wants a pool, needs three bedrooms and a fenced backyard. And like they got super, super specific with all three of those circles. And for me, I typically always kind of look at those, I have hot buyers, with skepticism. Like, do you really, like, is that just kind of a gimmick? But they were so specific that I literally looked at that and was like, wow, like they actually have buyers for those areas and they are very specific. And that was, it just created a sense of trust immediately. And I think that's such a smart way to approach it, of not like, hey, it's so hot, I've got a bunch of buyers, but like, I need this specific thing.
Well, the specificity really matters. And I think our friend over at BombBomb, Steve Passanelli, shared this concept with me. It's a psychology sort of phenomenon called the mirror exposure effect, which is the simple fact that people see you in more places inherently builds trust with your brand, which is why, if you think about it in the physical world, the mirror exposure effect is best represented when you're a listing agent and it's your signs and all the yards, you naturally just get more calls because people are like, oh, my neighbor listed with Sherry, clearly they know something I don't know, so I'm going to call Sherry. The same thing is true for digital. If you're in their inbox, if you're in their streams, if you're in their feeds, if you're on their channels, that exposure creates inherent trust, which is a key ingredient to actually building your brand and winning more listings. So I would encourage everyone on today's call who's listening, like what we're saying here is, think of yourself as a media company that happens to sell real estate. You've got to be out producing content at a rate that is so much greater than your competition that you can't help but be seen and you can't help but not be ignored. And that's what I think is smart agents are doing right now, Valerie.
Yeah. So I want to talk about prospecting for a minute, and Sherry and Zach, I'm going to have you go first on this one, but I know we've got a bunch of comments in chat that have sort of noted as we go along, and typically they're from newer agents, which totally makes sense. You know, when you're newer to the business, you've got to hustle for business. But a lot of the common questions are like, where do I start getting contacts? Like, where do I get people to talk to? How do I figure out who I should be having conversations with? Where do I start? And I know that, I know that Zach and Sherry, one of the things you do really well is just old school conversations. So what would be your advice around prospecting right now? Like, what are some of the basics that people should be doing no matter what the market in terms of just prospecting?
I think that a lot of times as agents, we look to see where can we get more leads. It's not where can we build more relationships. When you start focusing on how can I build more relationships of quality, then all of a sudden the listings will come into you because you're building those relationships. One of the things I love to do is, let's say I have buyer A looking to live in a specific community. Well, I've been in Santa Clarita for 20 years. I probably know someone that lives in that community. I pick up the phone and say, oh my gosh, I've got this cute, adorable family. I know you're not moving, but when you're talking to all your neighbors, will you make sure you drop my name? Because I've got to get somebody into that community. Have those conversations. Who's your neighbor that you know? Let me go talk to that neighbor. Start that real process. Hey, how are you doing, by the way? Life good? You're putting in a new pool? That's awesome. My clients want a pool in the future. Have those conversations with who's in that neighborhood. And again, it all comes back to fear, because I remember and know what does set me apart is that I can be fearless. I don't put in my head that that person doesn't want to hear from me. I don't hear that the person thinks I've contacted them too much. I hear that they're my best friend. I hear they love me. I don't know anything about them, but I hear nothing that has fear inside of it. And oftentimes we have had listings where I will tell Zach and I say, I think this guy forgets he's not my best friend and we've never met. I don't think he knows that we've never actually met. But it's having those conversations. And when your friend says, I have a friend that's thinking about selling, great, what's their phone number? I don't want to intrude on their privacy, but I'd love to give them a call and not make you the middleman. Right? Oftentimes we say, oh, why don't you have them give me a call? They're never going to call you. But most people are okay calling that person saying, hey, can I give your number to my realtor? Oh yeah, Sherry Brown, that's no problem. And when we have those conversations through Facebook and Instagram, a big part of our business is social media. So a lot of our business comes through Instagram and Facebook. A lot of people are people we don't even know. There's been referrals from out of state, but it's how are we looked at through Instagram and Facebook? Are we professional? Are we knowledgeable? And what kind of content are we putting out there? And I will post things that are conversation starters. I know if I'm low on my conversations, I'm going to say, hey, what do you guys think of this new restaurant in town? Has anyone been there? And what's your favorite dish? And now we can have all these conversations. Oh, by the way, anyone in your neighborhood thinking about selling? I'd love to call them.
I love that point of being fearless, because I think we've talked creativity, and to add fearlessness to that is so important. Like, if I have a client who's looking to buy a house with a pool, you know, on one hand, yes, I mean, I could track down every single house with a pool and start sending them postcards and say, hey, like, you know, do you want to sell your house? I have a client who wants a pool. Or I can call a couple of pool services in town and I could say, hey, do you have any clients who like hate their pool and complain every single time they have to have it serviced and would maybe like a house without a pool? You know, like, do you want to send me like maybe an intro to those people and start conversations that are, you know, with people that are on the sidelines of those, of that content. You don't necessarily always just have to like pepper the neighborhood with postcards and say, I need a pool. I think that fearlessness part is so important.
Well, you know, one of the things Zach and I talked about was we focus so much on all of these people we don't know, but we talk to lenders, escrow, title, all day long, home warranty gal, the handyman, the painter, all of these people are talking to people about real estate on a daily basis. And who are they sending their sellers to? Did you prove your value and give them something of value about yourself? So when they're talking and having those conversations, regardless if you use them or not, are they thinking Sherry and Zach, or are they thinking, I don't know which agent to give it to? It should be without a question that we're having conversations with our people in our industry, and they go, you know what, Sherry and Zach, I know they don't use me for escrow, but I'd love to send this lead to them because it makes sense.
Because you've shown your plan to them and you have a good plan, they trust you. They don't want to refer, you know, their trusted client to somebody who's not good. So again, it all comes back to having a good presentation, having value, showing that you deserve the listing. You didn't just beg for it.
Right.
So we do these client appreciation parties, and it's really interesting because a lot of the people in our industry are past clients or their family are past clients. So we'll have a client appreciation party and be five title reps there. We don't use any of them for title, but they're past clients, so they're there at the party.
Yeah, I love that.
I have some data that I think is worth sharing around this concept of prospecting, Valerie, because I think it's sort of central to both what Sherry and Zach were talking about. Because the thing that Sherry said at the beginning of today's session, she's like, you know, I have a conversation goal every day. You know, Harvard Business Review did a study on this. They found that people who actually have goals and write them down are 10 times more likely to achieve them. So she's doing the basics really well, which is a mark of a great professional. I think we can't jump over that just to talk about, you know, very specific strategies. But let me give you some data around sales that's really important. On average, 92% of all sales reps make less than 4 attempts to contact a prospect in their database or network. Over 50% of all sales happen after the 5th attempt. Okay. So right there, that conversion gap exists because we develop this false narrative that if a consumer doesn't respond to our first or second or third attempt, that they're not interested. When in reality, they may be on vacation, they may be busy, they may be having like to deal with at-home schooling or they're applying for a new job. And so we have to first and foremost realize that persistence in sales pays off. It always has, it always will, especially in a world that we live in today, which we're always being bombarded with notifications. The second thing everyone should know, and this is a study that we did internally at Curator, analyzing over 40,000 conversations on prospecting. There's a technique in prospecting that is far more effective than traditional prospecting, which is traditional prospecting is typically single channel approach. You either use email, text, or phone. Now, when you use a single channel approach, what tends to happen is your appointment rate from an outreach to appointment is between 0.2% to 1.2%. That's the data we collected. So 0.2% to 1.2%. The moment that you start to add a essentially double channel, right, where you do phone and text, phone and email, email and text, your appointment rate will skyrocket from basically 0.2% to on average 1.4% to 3.2%. Where it gets really special is when you enter into the triple threat, which is for every attempt that you make, you call, text, and email. Our data shows that the appointment rate per attempt is 6.25%. So what I want everyone on this call to realize here is that there are some fundamentals that exist within business that if you overlook, you're setting yourself up to fail. If you're not prospecting consistently, you're not actually making 4, 5, 6, 7 attempts, you are leaving money on the table. If you have a single channel approach, if you're like, hey, I just like emailing people, I'm going to do my 80 outreaches via email. Congratulations, you're going to convert at 0.2%. You know, it's just not enough. And so for the agents who are willing to go the extra mile, they're just performing at such a high rate. And it has this sort of self-fulfilling prophecy where you start converting at a higher rate. And because that's like so motivating for your business and sales, you want to do more of it. And because you do more of it, you convert at a higher rate. And so the cycle continues. Like this is information that everybody has to know and understand. And it has to be a cornerstone part of their strategy. So layer that on top of what Sherry is doing, establish the goal, but make sure the environment and the strategy is designed to actually help you succeed, as opposed to just bang your head against the wall, emailing people and wondering why aren't they replying.
Yeah.
And I think people want to be, they want to talk how they, I want text message. I want to be emailed. I will never know how that person wants to communicate until I either ask or figure it out with the way they respond.
Excellent point.
Yeah. So true. And that ties into like your fearless conversation, Sherry, too. It's like so many people, like they convince themselves that after two tries, when the person hasn't picked up the phone or responded to their email, that that person doesn't want to be bothered. And they get this fear of like, now I'm bothering them. Mm-hmm. So they just don't.
You make up something in your head of why they didn't get back. And then you convince yourself that you shouldn't go any further. And it's just that voice in the back of your head. You need to get past that. That's a huge part of this.
Yeah.
The greatest feeling when you finally reach that lead and they go, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry I didn't get back to you. I was actually traveling with no cell service up in the mountains and I had anxiety not answering you. You're like, thanks, because I had anxiety you weren't answering me too. But we say rule of thumb on our team, 15 attempts in various different ways, text, email, call, Facebook, Instagram, you know, 15 attempts within 72 hours.
Sure.
Yeah. And let me give a very specific piece of advice here. Cause I think the attempt really matters. And clearly, I'm loving what Sherry and Zach are sharing. Cause I think it's just fun to see agents doing it the right way. There's an attempt that I think is pretty standard in our industry. And maybe it sounds a bit like this. You say, hey, Valerie, Jimmy here. I saw that you're on my website recently, looking at properties. I'm here if you need anything else, like, let me know. I'm looking forward to hearing from you. Now, that sounds on the surface like a generally polite message. You're trying to be helpful, but we have got to stop waiting to be useful. And we just need to go out there and be useful. So a different approach that I've coached our clients on is this idea of using the presumptive sale technique, which is through your language, you are essentially already going to work for the client. So instead of reaching out that way, whether it's through text, through email, through a DM on Instagram, whatever it is, right? You might say something like this. Hey, Valerie, Jimmy here. I saw you on my website recently. I'm going to spend some time this afternoon putting together a list of properties that I think you're going to be interested in. I'll circle back at 3:00 today to give you an update. So I'm not even asking if they want the email. I'm doing a presumptive sale technique. Now, what's going to happen is at 3 p.m., and we coach this in the book we wrote, Exactly What to Say for Real Estate Agents. At 3 p.m., we say, hey, Valerie, it's Jimmy. As promised, I'm reaching back out to give you an update on those three properties. Let me know if you got some time right now, or I might even say, I'm going to call you right now, like in advance, I'm texting them, and I pick up the phone and call them. And now all of a sudden we have demonstrated that we are actually going to do what we say. And that covers that trust gap. So from my perspective, everything that Sherry and Zach are doing, setting goals, having a plan around how many attempts you have to make, going multi-channel, think about the actual impact of the outreach. Don't waste their time. Mm-hmm. Don't be polite. Don't try to be too like cordial. Like, get to the point.
Yep.
Prove that you can actually add value, and then go out there and do that consistently, day in, day out. And you know, you're not going to be worried about getting listings at that point.
I mean, I think that's why the proactive CMA is my favorite go-to, like of all time, is not like, hey, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, if you're ever thinking about selling, if you'd like me to give you a CMA, let me know, versus, hey, if you're ever thinking about selling, you're probably interested right now in what your house might be worth. So here's the last three sales in your neighborhood that would be, you know, comps. And here's the three that are for sale right now that you'd be competing against. Let me know if you have questions. Like, it's so different from the, oh, could I please maybe, to like, hey, here's some value. I'm smart. I know what I'm talking about. You know, there's such a difference in just that short bit of tone. And I think sometimes we sit back and we do the whole, like, I'm never too busy for your referrals. When instead we could be like, hey, I have important stuff you should know, and it's going to make a difference in the value of your, you know, your biggest asset. Like, go in with that information. Jimmy's so right. Like I think a lot of times we sit back and ask permission to help, you know, like why? Just help. Right. And then that's going to, you know, expand in my
opinion. We're their agent and they're my best friend. That's all I hear. I don't see anything else. They don't know anything different and I don't know anything different. And when they don't respond on temp 10 or 11, I go, hey, I want to make sure you're getting my messages. I realize I've sent a few different messages in various channels. I didn't hear back. Are you getting these? Mm-hmm. Oh yeah. So sorry. Because I'm not going to stop. I'm going to text you tomorrow morning if I don't hear from you, but let me know you're getting these messages because it's really important information. Yeah. Oh yeah, I'm getting them.
Yeah.
I think there's one thing consumers want is they want aggressive agents. Mm-hmm. Now they don't want pushy agents, but they want their agents to be aggressive, right? And that you got to walk that line, but like, hey, like this is my job. This is how hard I'm working to win your business. Can you imagine what happens when I actually get your business? And I think every consumer, like if you go to Google and you type in my real estate agent is, I look at just to do this right now. Can we pull it up, please? Like, is there a way to screen share? Right?
Oh,
like my real estate agent is, and one of the results you typically see in it, like my real estate agent is lazy, right? Has lied to me, is unresponsive, is too
busy. Unresponsive, rude, too busy, ignoring me, lazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is lying.
How sad.
Yeah. And like number 9 on the list is like, is doing a good job. Like, why are you Googling that? Like, is that, like, are you just like, Google that to have a conversation with Google? So there's a book everyone should read. So this is my point is Google represents the actual search history of consumers. So this is the perception that we are all up against. Now, the book that you should read is a book called Challenger Sale. Because what Valerie and Sherry and Zach are all talking about is the Challenger Sale Techniques talks about how the high performing sales reps across all these different organizations have one thing in common, which is they are educating and challenging the conventional wisdom that consumers have about the products or services that they sell as a way for the consumer to say, I didn't know that. That's interesting. What else do I not know? And now you become the person who is the arbiter of truth and the arbiter of information there. So the book's called The Challenger Sale. Marianna. So the thing that I want to bring up, though, because you said it earlier, Valerie, I don't want to forget. This webinar needs to be like 4 hours long, by the way.
I know, right? I was I'm looking at the clock like, I've got a bunch more questions.
there's a strategy that you brought up that I want to solidify and quantify for everyone in today's call. There's a guy, this again, giving my second shout out to Steve Passanelli, because I had him on the water cooler a while back. He introduced me to this guy named Jimmy Burgess, called the Jimmy Burgess strategy. I have now shortened into the Jimmy strategy. But the Jimmy Burgess strategy is basically where you send an unsolicited CMA to people who you have maybe their address or you have like in your database, they're not asking for it. And what you do is you pull up Google Earth, right? Street view of their property as the first frame. And then, so when they get the video in their inbox or on social, like the first thing you see is you're outside their house. Well, that has what we call marketing stopping power. Mm-hmm. You're like, okay, wait a second. This is not generic. Like it's a signal. This is something unique. And then he quickly jumps over to the CMA he prepared for them saying, hey, just sending this email because we have, I did an analysis of your property. I got a bunch of sold. I got some information for you. He put in 90 days, he put $11 million under contract using that one technique, just sending a few of these every single day. So, there are many different approaches, the Heather Buckman strategy, the what's your plan strategy, using that name your price strategy, using the Jimmy Burgess strategy. But to Sherry and Zach's earlier point, if you have a goal in mind, you say, if I'm not hitting it, I got to get creative. I got to try new things. So the Jimmy Burgess strategy is the exact example, Valerie, of like unsolicited CMAs, just producing results for that agent, doing something other agents are unwilling to do.
Yeah, love that. Okay, we've got some questions I'm going to dig into from the audience. But first, I always like to ask this question on pretty much every panel I ever moderate ever. Because I think it's really telling. What are really good agents and teams spending their money on right now? And what are they not spending money on? Thoughts on this? Zach, Sherry, what are you guys spending your money on? What are you not spending money on?
So it's different. We're in LA County, which we've been very closed down here. So we're very limited in our actual face-to-face contact right now. So we've stepped up our buys. We've stepped up to make sure that every month, every holiday, we have a list of 150. I mean, it's revolving because our database is really, really big. So we try to take 150 of our A-listers and make sure that they get some sort of goodie from us, whether it's cake pops or we did succulent plants recently, which was super affordable at $5.
We did both of those for Valentine's Day and got two listings out of it.
Sweet.
And they weren't even, I had three where they weren't even thinking about selling, but they called to tell us how great the cake pops were. We started talking about real estate and what if you could get this price for your house? And they said, absolutely, let's do it. Let's go on the market next week. And they're going to both go to Airbnbs. They don't have a plan. They don't know where they're moving to.
So you guys are spending money on personal touch.
Yeah.
Because we typically do four parties a year, one per quarter. And that's a good way for us to stay in front of our sphere. Last year, we sold 159 houses, 83 listings. Out of those 83, 30 of them came directly from our sphere. Mm-hmm. So we really spend a lot of time, effort, and energy trying to stay in front of our sphere. Right now, because we can't do parties, mm-hmm. we're trying to do other things to stay in front of our people.
Love that.
And YouTube advertising. YouTube advertising has been great for us because we can put these videos out there, spend $20 to $30. And these are targeted ads that are going to people who are on YouTube. With everybody at home right now, we get the call. We got a client that called us last week and she was playing Candy Crush. And she said, oh my gosh, your video is on my Candy Crush game. And I was like, that's awesome. She's like, no, it's not. I have to watch it for 30 seconds. It's annoying. And I'm like, that's great. And I'm like, and also what are you clicking on? Because you shouldn't see my ad unless you've clicked on a Zestimate. So are you thinking about moving? She goes, well, we're thinking about doing a refinance. And I'm like, well, you're busted because you saw my video and that was only supposed to go to a targeted buyer.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's a perfect segue. We didn't plan this, but I see really smart agents investing in video, but more specifically YouTube advertising. YouTube advertising revenue last quarter was $7 billion. To put that in perspective, Facebook probably brought in between $25 to $30 billion. And this is something that I've been paying very close attention to for the better part of the last 24 months. YouTube is the next big channel. Forget about TikTok for a second. I'm not anti-TikTok, but I want to provide some perspective. YouTube is second or third, depending on how you grade it, largest search engine in the world. There are so few advertisers right now in real estate on YouTube. I started my career, Valerie, you know this, in Facebook. I built a Facebook application that I sold to real estate agents for $10 a month. That was tough sledding. And what I believed at the time is that Facebook has become the single biggest channel in real estate. And this was a decade ago. And now Facebook is really pros only. It requires, I believe, and obviously I'm biased because we do this, but I believe it requires people who actually have experience running Facebook ads to be able to effectively generate a serious ROI. YouTube, on the other hand, is the next great frontier. Sherry brought up a great point. You can spend $30 and get 3,000 views on your video. But more importantly, those videos can be targeted in such ways where you can target by geolocation, but then you can layer in something called in-market. So you can do retargeting, which is they interact with your brand. You can retarget them with a YouTube video, but you can also do in-market audiences, which is if someone is searching for homes for sale in LA, as an example, well, those keywords on Google are going to be pretty damn expensive, but you can actually target them with your videos at a fraction of the cost, because most agents don't have the necessary element to run YouTube ads, which is video content. So what I would be encouraging everyone here to do, and what should you be investing in, is high quality video and smart distribution. Yes. This is the 82% Valerie of all traffic on the internet in the next 24 months is going to be video. If you do not have a video strategy, you don't have a marketing strategy. Short form, long form, going live, one-to-one. Like it is, we feel like we're preaching to the choir here, Valerie. We've been talking about video now for the better part of 5 years, right? If not longer. But it's no longer becoming a nice to have. It has passed that point. Yeah. So it's not just creation, but creation plus distribution. That's where smart agents are spending. One last thing, Valerie, I'm sorry. I just talked to, right before this call, I just spoke to Ken Pozak, who is an agent here in Orlando. He's going to do $100 million this year in real estate. The guy is, I wish we could find his YouTube channel. Just this stuff is just great. His big three is agent referrals, right? Instagram and YouTube. He has a little bit of farming too, but like that's his big three. He doesn't do any prospecting. He goes, Jimmy, I got so many inbound leads coming in right now. I got to figure out a better way to handle these things because I'm just like leaving money on the table. He's not even prospecting. He's at that point where his marketing is so good. His videos are so well done. It's bringing in inbound business.
Yeah.
A good problem to have.
Yeah.
And it's twofold. We put our listings on YouTube and run ads on those. And then in our listing presentation, we can say, go look at our channel. Every one of our listings gets 3,000, 5,000, 8,000 views. And then that's how we're showing that we have this marketing plan to push your property. That's how we're getting hired. And it's all, you know, and then it's branding. So it's all just wrapped into each other.
Mm-hmm. I leave every appointment or when we're talking to potential sellers. And I said, do yourself a favor. I thank you for the opportunity to interview us, interview other agents. I encourage that. Then look them up on Instagram and YouTube and see what their online presence is. Their online presence is what your property is going to have. So if you feel like they got enough click and views and have a good following, then that is great. But I can assure you, no one has a better presence than we do.
Yeah. I love that. And I had somebody on here as a guest a couple of weeks ago, and they said, if you are saying something more than twice, make a video, you know, like for pretty much everything in your business. If you're, if you're answering a question more than twice, if you're giving somebody information more than twice, make a video, because guaranteed, like that's going to drive traffic. And that's, there are people that are asking that question over and over. I thought that was so smart.
Yeah. And I just dropped Ken's link to his YouTube channel and Brad McCollum. I would check out both of those individuals. I think both of them are doing video at an elite level. But let me just say one more thing about video, because I think there's a lesson here, Valerie, that's really important, is that you have different types of video. We're currently doing a live video that's being recorded that will be repurposed in the email. We upload it to a YouTube channel. We'll probably be running a YouTube ad behind it. So we're doing something that can live on for a long period of time. Mm-hmm. As content marketers, if we want to build a marketing flywheel, we have to do both short form, which is in the feed, in the moment, right? And long form. Too often, agents focus so much on short form content that has no staying power. Last month, we generated like 20,000 unique visitors to our website who came in organically on content we produced 5 years ago. Yeah. And it's like, you know, that's just, you can't recreate that if everything is in the feed. But I will say one thing, quality matters. Mm-hmm. And I want everyone here to set the standard to be higher. Getting your camera and just doing this is okay for certain scenarios. But if you want to stand out, quality matters. I'm not just talking about the quality of the production, meaning the camera, the mic, the lights, all that. I'm talking about the post-production. If you're going to be in short form, you'll see, like, even with my stuff on Instagram as of late, I've been investing in short, and the responses are 10 times better. Yeah. So quality matters. Post-production matters. It's how you stand out. It's how you build that brand presence. It's how you differentiate yourself, which is essential if you want to win listings.
Yeah. Okay. So we have talked about conversations, prospecting, video, ways to have conversations. We've talked about pop buys. We've talked about what to spend money on. We've talked about what people are doing right now to start conversations with the people that are in their database. We've talked about making sure that you're responding to leads multiple times to make sure you're converting those. And we're talking about having multiple streams of conversations. So I think we've dropped a ton of knowledge. I'm going to let you guys think for just 30 seconds while I talk about Realvolve for a second, because I'm going to ask you in a minute to give your best piece of advice for people that are listening. Something that, you know, they can really like take away and do after this. Not that you haven't already dropped a ton of that advice, but I'm going to let you give your best piece of advice. But for 1 second, I just want to talk to our audience really quickly about Realvolve and Firepoint. We've got some great services for you here. If you are listening to this conversation today and you're feeling a little bit like you are on the back foot when it comes to some of these things, like if you're thinking, I don't follow up with my clients. I don't follow up more than twice. I don't have a system that's going to allow me to lead nurture. I don't have a way to send out text messages and emails and record my phone calls and make sure that I know what I'm, you know, like how many times I've had a conversation with my contacts. If I don't have integration with my lead gen and my CRM, we want to help you with that. So if you are in the market for a new CRM, if you need some tools that are going to help you make sure nothing falls through the cracks, that helps you run your back end of your business and have these conversations and get more listings, we'd love to help you. So reach out to us at realvolve.com/demo or firepoint.net/demo. And we would love to give you a personal tour through some of these products and help you decide if they are right for you. Okay.
You absolutely need a CRM.
Absolutely.
You absolutely need a CRM. If anybody out there does not have a CRM, you should be doing that today.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. So I've got your faces on the screen and your company names for those that are writing this down. I would love for you each to give me your best advice for teams, brokers, agents in 2021, listings related, if possible, but best advice for those that are listening and thinking, I want to make better decisions in my business. I want to spend my money better. The way we were talking earlier, I want to be better at following up. What's the one thing I could do? If you could give them the one thing, Zach, Sherry, which of you would like to go first?
I'll go. I think a big part of everything here is, okay, you're going to step up your game. You're going to start contacting more people, but you've got to have the systems in place to be able to facilitate the listings. And that starts even with your listing presentation. You know, we do not ever not do our listing presentation. If my cousin calls me, we're doing our listing presentation. If a random stranger calls me, we're doing our listing presentation. We work on our listing presentation. It's constantly evolving. We're adding things. I'll go in if we have one today and I'll add our sales from last week. We want it to be current and up to date and have examples. We're really proud of our success rate. A couple of years ago, we went on 62 appointments and got 61 of them. Wow. That was 2 years back. Last year, we went on 87 appointments, got 83 of them, you know, and we accredit ourselves to that listing presentation and being able to explain our system. And we have a plan in place to facilitate your listing. Mm-hmm. So that, I think that's my best advice.
I love that. And because we had a
gangster ass listing
systems. And I love that, Zach, of just like consistency of your system. Don't just have one that you change for every single, you know, opportunity, but like consistently talking about your systems. I think.
And our sellers love that. We have a plan. We only go on the market on Wednesdays because then we can start running all of our ads and synchronizing everything on Thursdays. And then we're facilitating showing we have a plan. Our plan does not change. The plan is, we've had people say, we went with you. And again, we're going four or five people at a time. We went with you because you have a plan.
Love it. Sherry, best piece of advice.
Our life. That helps our life as well, because when we have a plan like that, then we can go on 10 listing appointments in a week, because we know what we're doing on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday at these allotted times. And on not those times, we're going on listing appointments. But the number one thing for me, and I've talked about this before, if anyone's ever heard me speak, is my ABC method, right? Brand new agent, look at your phone. How many contacts do you have? You start with the A's. You call everybody in your phone, your Facebook, your Instagram, and your emails that starts with the letter A. Tomorrow you do B, the next day you do C, and the next day you do D, until you get organized enough to put them in your CRM to make sure that you follow a plan. But the easiest way to start having no one in your database, thinking you only know 50 people, is start with the letter A today. And then if something happens, I've got kids, my kid may puke tomorrow and I can't get to the B's, but I know I left off on that letter A. So in 2 days, I'm going to go with B. And I just keep doing that all through the year and make sure I hit A through Z over and over and over.
Love that. Love that. Jimmy, best piece of advice for agents and teams right now?
Muted.
First time using Zoom. Sorry about that, guys. real quickly, I dropped in my chat where you guys can follow me if you want to just keep getting advice on marketing and listings and lead generation and conversion. It's on my Instagram. I usually update that every day or every other day with content. In terms of my best advice, you know, I have 50, 55 employees that work for me, a curator, full-time, salaried, make great money, great insurance, benefit employees, right? And one thing I've learned about building and scaling a business is that at a certain point, operations will make or break you. Meaning my individual talent, my partner, Chris Smith, his talent, our personalities, right? Like that can get us to a certain point. But as you scale, you have to have operations in place. And both Zach and Sherry talked about this. For them, a cornerstone part of that is their listing presentation. It's an operation. It's something they refine and work on over and over again. I believe to build a real estate team in 2021 in the future, you have got to become an operation-driven business, not an agent-driven business. And there are core operations that you need to standardize. Certainly your marketing, certainly your sales, and absolutely the experience, but also post-close, which is right now in real estate, we have an awful retention record. 87% of consumers say they'd use their agent again, like freaking 15% actually do. We have a leaky bucket in real estate, and we need to focus on saying, well, maybe putting them on like a drip campaign where we email like our VIPs once every 6 months isn't a good idea because it ain't working. And so we got to just embrace that idea. And also, by the way, calling up and say, hey, I'm never too busy for referrals. Like I know I get hate every time I say this, but it's like, it's just a stupid thing to say because it's all about you. Like you have to focus on adding value. So those operations need to be in place. My advice is, Peter Drucker is accredited to saying this, the father of modern management. He said, you can't manage what you don't measure. Measure the things that matter within your business, whether it's conversations, whether it's organizing your A, B's and C's, whether it's your, and Zach just spitting out, hey, 87 listing appointments, we want 83 of them. Measure the things that matter and focus on improving those. And if you can do that, you will over time build a great business in real estate.
Love it. Well, we are over time and I think we could go on for another hour, but we're gonna shut it down. Couple of quick things. Jesse Peters, I see your 1,000 questions in and Q&A for Sherry about how she does YouTube advertising. Please hook up with her directly. She would be over the moon to give you some information about how she advertises on YouTube. Jesse's a good guy, Sherry. He's an all right one to share with.
Oh, nice.
For the rest of you, thank you so much for participating today, for sticking with us, for asking so many great questions, for participating in chat. We hope, as always, that you got a ton of value out of this. We did record it. We will make sure that you get a copy. We will send that out. Zach and Sherry, how can people reach out to you if they want to talk to you about some of the things you shared, if they want to send you referrals, if they want to hire you, how can they reach you?
Go ahead, Sherry.
I'd say definitely follow me on Instagram. I will drop a link in there. Awesome Town Sherry Brown is my name. And or hit me up on Facebook. I love engaging on social media.
Awesome. And Jimmy, best way for people to reach you? I know you dropped your Insta in the chat. Yeah.
Follow me on Instagram. Yeah, my brand strategist has convinced me to finally get on the Instagram train. I know it's this... it's been a lot of fun making some great connections there. So you follow me on Instagram. That's where you're not going to see, like, my strategy is I just don't post pictures of my kids. It's not because I'm against that. It's just because, I have one kid, but it's, because like, I'm just trying to provide value. It's really a business channel for people to follow if they want advice on marketing and sales and advertising. So at Jimmy Mackin on Instagram.
Awesome. Well, on my behalf and for Realvolve and Firepoint, thank you, all three of you, for participating today, for sharing all your wisdom, for being so much fun. I love all of you and I love chatting with you. And this was a hoot. So I really appreciate it. Thank you so much for your generosity. And I hope to see you in person again soon.
Yes, I need that. I need a hug.
Instagram for our business is pretty much just look up Sherry and Zach, and you can find us on YouTube, on Facebook, on Instagram. Sherry is spelled like cherries with no S. Sherry and Zach.
Awesome.
But thank you guys for having us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Everyone else, have a wonderful day and thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next time.
Yay.
Bye.